Pastor Young to bring us the word, and also want two of the church workers are out today to visualize that. So we're going to be. So let's receive Pastor Hill. Pastor Hill.
Give honor to the Lord Jesus. Amen. I thank God for his goodness this morning. And we just want you to be happy today. I know it's not that hot. I think somebody had the windows. I had the curtains open. It would have been a lot better if I had to open this side here. But Brother Travis told us to all have opened this side here. But the heat started coming in. So happy for Brother Kelvin, friends, but can't be my meat. Jeff is this week on the yard. And Brother Walter does it every week. And he's going to hopefully be helping us out as well. We got the man next door that does all of the real tall cutting. He comes over with his big tractor. We have to pay him, but everything else, God is blessing us to get volunteers. Amen. So we just thank God for these brothers that's kicking in, and that's really been a blessing, and really working in the interest of the kingdom of God here in this church. We really appreciate that. Amen. Well, James really shocked me this morning. He came from about 9 o'clock. And he was out there, man, he was just going as fast as he could go. And I didn't think he could go that fast. But that was a real blessing, and we just thank God for him. Didn't even ask him, he just volunteered. Amen. All right, I just wanted to say that I've been blessed, Sister Hills, with all of the sharing testimonials that we've been blessed to receive from the membership, and it's been a real blessing to all of us as well. And I want you to bow your head just for a moment. Just want to give God praise and thanksgiving. And this is for the Word of God. You know, we want to praise Him for the Word. Praise Him for the Word. We don't want to come and receive the Word. The Word is not life. Scripture says the Word is life to them that what? Find it. Amen. It's the life that's in us that causes the Word to be alive to us. So we just want to have a word of prayer and just give God praise and the glory. Although it might not be as cool as you desire, but yet we can still praise God. Amen. Father, we thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient. We thank you, God, that you always causes us to triumph. You always given us the victory. We thank you, Father, for the peace of God that passes all understanding. The joy that's unspeakable, full of glory. Father, we thank you that your name is still prevailing. You're still prevailing in heaven, you're still prevailing on the earth, still prevailing underneath the earth. The name that you've given us is a name that we cherish. It's a very honorable, powerful, glorious, mighty name. Lord, at the name of Jesus, yes, everything that's created has to submit. Every knee bowed, every tongue confess. Jesus, your Lord. Yeah, over my circumstances, your Lord. Over every force of the enemy, every weapon that the enemy launches against you, you are Lord. No weapon formed against us will prosper. We thank you, Lord, that Satan is under our feet. Yes, and there is nothing that he can do to thwart the plan of God. Lord, your word is a prevailing word. Heaven and earth may pass, but not one jot or tittle of your word will ever pass away until all of it is done. Lord, we are complete in you. Oh God, you will perfect that which concerns all of us. Lord, if we cast our cares upon you and turn all of the things that we are anxious about over to you. You said that in all things by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let our requests be made known. Heck yes. And the peace of God. The peace of God. Everybody just said the peace of God. The peace of God that passes all understanding keeps my heart. It will keep my heart and my mind. In perfect peace. Lord, you said you will keep us in perfect peace. Hey, glory. When our minds are stayed on you. Oh God, the images of your word given. Light and given understanding. Lord, we thank you that the peace of God is the thing that we thank you for today. Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, that we are more than conquerors. The overcomers of this life, and we reign in this life through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. We reign. We are on top. Satan is under our feet. Satan is already defeated. He has already been dethroned. Oh God, and no weapon that is launched against us will succeed. Father, we give you the praise and the glory. Hey, calling the things that be not. As though they are. Lord, you are the strength of my life. You are the light of my salvation. Oh God, every good and every perfect gift coming from above. Yes, from you. We thank you, Lord. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Oh, thank you, Lord, for the name. The name, the precious name. Hallelujah. Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to turn to the scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:21. We are in the process of sharing with you the difference between holiness and righteousness, and we're focusing now on righteousness. Many times when we hear the word righteousness and holiness, we kind of put both of them in the same category, but there is a distinct difference between, especially in the New Testament, when it comes to righteousness and holiness. Righteousness is what we're going to be speaking about today. We talked a lot about holiness. Sometimes people get kind of nervous when you talk too much about holiness. And because holiness is your walk, how you live, and how you walk in your righteousness. Amen. When you come to holiness, you're dealing with the body. Everybody say the body.
The body.
He says, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your body a what? A living sacrifice. Whenever you're speaking about holiness, amen, you're always speaking about things which are carried out, are done, are performed in the physical body. Things that you do in your physical body, your actions as a person pertaining to your physical body. That's the reason why the Bible says so many things about putting on, putting off. Let not sin reign in your mortal body. Right? The Bible says a whole lot about yielding your members as instruments of righteousness unto yielding your members as instruments of righteousness unto righteousness and not unto sin. So the Bible admonishes us many times what to do with our bodies and what not to do with our bodies. One scripture says, put away this, put away that. Then it says, put on this, put on what? That. Okay, so activities that the Bible speaks about that pertain to your body. Yielding your body, or offering up your body as a sacrifice, that refers to holiness. Holiness is the way of the way of life. Amen. Your manner of lifestyle, a manner of. Amen. Now, here's a scripture that you have heard about a whole lot. It says Hebrews. It says, "Lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." That's Hebrews 12:1. So that's speaking about holiness. Lay aside every weight. In other words, stop following the course of this world, or the course of that your flesh will dictate. So you have a lot of scriptures, and when you begin to look at don't do this, don't do that, do this, do that, and pull off, put on, and all that, sometimes people just have to forget it all. Even I can't do all of that stuff the Bible tells me to do, so I just going to do the best I can and leave the rest up to God. But the key to understanding how you can do all of this and really please God in your body is really contingent upon your understanding of righteousness. If you don't understand righteousness, then you're going to find all of the commands and all of the do's and don'ts and all of the things that the Bible tells us put on and pull off and lay aside and all of that. You're going to find it something that would be very laborious, or something that probably you call it legalistic and things of that nature. But when you begin to look at the word righteousness, righteousness is not how you live, it's the standing that you have with God. It's the position that you occupy in the sight of God, the position. And let me just give you an illustration. When God placed Adam on this earth, he gave him the highest position of any created thing that he had made. He was to represent God, take the place of God, and to carry out God's will and God's purpose upon this earth. That was a very high honor and a position that God gave him. Everything God created, he turned it over to Adam. So Adam could what? He could be the person that would what? He would manage or to carry out God's will and to keep everything that God created in the right perspective. So that was a high honor. So God made him. Amen. God made Adam as close to himself as it was possible. Bible says God made him just a little lower than angels. Made him just a little lower. In other words, just slightly inferior to God himself. Amen. See, he had to make man this way in order for man to be able to carry out his role as what? The supreme ruler of the universe. Amen. Amen. So that was a high position. He made him in right standing. And when we say right standing, which is righteousness, righteousness simply means that you're in right standing with God. You have a position that you're actually carrying out God's will and all of the power and authority and everything God created. Amen. Even the presence, entering into his presence, in other words, the privilege of entering into God's presence at will, talking to God face to face like Moses talked to him. All that is a part of your right standing. If you're in right standing with God, you have boldness and confidence Amen. To the one that has placed what? The authority in your hand. You have confidence, right? Boldness. Your own what? Speaking terms. You're in close fellowship. Amen. Everybody just said close fellowship. You hooked up real what? Real tight. Amen. How many, amen, think that that was a real good honor? The Bible says, what is man? That's Romans 8:5. What is man? Hey, I'm getting poetic like Sister Hill. I'm becoming happy. Hey, what is man? That's too much. What is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou art visited him. Thou hast made him, that Lord of Lords and angels, crown him with what? Glory and honor. And has placed all things under his feet. Oh, that's the way God created man. So that was a position that was what? Above every position that God had what? Created. Man is called the crown of God's creation. Amen. Everybody just said the crown. Crown of God's creation. So that shows that, I mean, to me, when I think about righteousness, I think about three different components. You got to begin to think of, in terms of what's involved in right standing with God. I mean, this is the same thing if you were in right standing with your company. If a company had invested aligning to your spiritual, I mean, your development and education, your training and all of that, then there are certain privileges and honors that they're going to what? Bestow upon you. And one of them is going to be, you're going to have access to a person that is head of the company. You're going to have standing, an open what? Open, what you call it? In other words, anytime you want to come into their presence, it's an open door. Amen. You're going to what? Be able to what? Communicate and talk if you're in good standing. Amen. Is that right? Your boss? Amen. Whoever's over you, you got to have what? Open what? An open door. You got to be able to what? Communicate. If they're going to want you to do this or want you to do that, you're going to have to be able to what? You're going to have to be able to what? Communicate. Amen. Did God make Adam where he could communicate to him? Absolutely. Is that right? He had free access into what? Access into God's what? Presence. Amen. Fellowship. How many can say? Yeah, oh, glory. That was the main reason why God created Adam. Because he wanted somebody that he could what? Communicate with on his level. He wanted an offspring, right? He wanted somebody, amen, that was a part of him that he could actually place over the universe and stay in close what? Communion or in close fellowship with that person. Because if he could stay in close fellowship, he could what? He could run the universe through that person. He could tell them what everything, reveal to them. Glory! No secrets, everything is what? Open. So we call that priesthood. I mean, when you have access to the kingdom, to the throne, and come in God's presence, anytime you have a need to come, we call that, amen, priesthood, the ability, amen, to what? To come into God's presence without a sense of feeling what? Unwanted or unworthy or insufficient or incapable. Amen. You have unlimited access into the Father's presence. Everybody can say amen.
Amen.
Hey, the Bible says that we have access with boldness, with confidence, with the blood.
Amen.
See, Adam messed it up. And then the only way man could actually communicate with God after Adam disobeyed God, man had to what? Go through a what? A priesthood. And there were certain rules that they had to follow in order to what? to enter into God's presence. It wasn't like it was at first, but now I'm what? Mess it up. I'm going to say amen. And sometimes God, I mean, most times God never talked with people face to face directly. He talked, by the way, with an angel. Right? You heard a voice way over here somewhere, and it came from an angel. But God, see, man forfeited his what? His ability to come directly into God's presence and to talk with him face to face. Amen. So all the Old Testament writings and things of that nature, God could only talk with man on an intimate basis. It had to be through a dream. Amen. Wouldn't it be terrible now if the only way you could touch God and come in God's presence through a dream? Well, I gotta go to sleep. A dream, a vision, or over bleeding, sacrifice, or it had to be a way, because God was no longer committed to live in the heart of man where he could have what? Direct access to what? Man's, amen, and really for man to enjoy his presence. So man could not talk with God, or communicate with God, or fellowship with God on a very intimate basis, amen, until, amen, Jesus came and what? Restored men back into fellowship. Amen. So we ought to be glad, but the Bible says that we have confidence. Now, amen, we have confidence as we enter into God's presence because the blood of Jesus has what? The scripture says when we were in his when we were alienated and unions in our minds by what? Wicked words. Amen. The Lord God reconciled us to Jesus. We were reconciled through what? The death. Amen. The blood of Jesus. When we were, just think about that. When we were, what I said, alienated and enemies in our own minds by what? Wicked words. That doesn't sound like to me you were in a good position. Right? You weren't in a position where you have what? Direct access. How many will thank you? Amen. Somebody said, I got a telephone in my bosom. And I can what? Call them up from my heart. Amen. There are some things I can do. I can just say certain things. Amen. Down in prayer. Certain things. And many times these things that I say are no more than some of those provisions that Christ has what made possible. Sometimes I'll be thinking about things like this. And when I was dead in trespasses and sin, he quickly needed to go with him. Amen. That doesn't mean a whole lot to a lot of people. Amen. When I was dead in trespasses and sin, I was quickened together. Amen. Quickened together. In other words, made alive. When I was dead in trespasses and sin, Christ, amen, but God, what, quickened me and made me alive. Yeah. Amen. And placed me in Christ. Yeah. Amen. I went from the kingdom of darkness. Yeah. Amen. I went from the kingdom of darkness, yeah, to the kingdom of light. Yeah. And I was, amen. That meant what? Direct? Ooh. Direct access. Yeah. Oh, amen. Oh, I'm gonna read, amen, that scripture. See, that's what I mean when you begin to think about right standing with God. The first thing you think about, I have direct communications. I have a close, I've been called into fellowship. I've been called. God called me into fellowship with his son. How many of you know that was a great call? But he had planned that from the foundation of the world. Before man sinned, God knew he would, but he had an answer. Amen. In other words, he had a remedy for the problem before the problem even resolved. Yes. Chosen in him. Yes. Before the foundation of the world, that I may be holy and without blame. That's the only way you can come into God's presence and really enjoy his fellowship with him. You got to be what? You got to be holy and without blame. Yes. But that was what the redemption work of Christ was all about. To make me holy. Hey. All right, Colossians 1:21, I believe it's in, amen. Just look at that. That was the work of our redemption, to make us holy and without blame. See, that's the reason why you need to understand what your what righteousness is all about. We've been made righteous. Okay, Colossians 1:21. Okay, did that right? Does that sound right? Yeah, okay. You who sometimes were what?
Alienated
and what?
In your mind by wicked works. Yet now have you reconciled.
Okay, continue to read that.
In the body of the flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight.
Okay, all of that redemption work was an effort to present you what? Holy and what? Unblameable and unreprovable. In other words, nobody, after God works you over, the scripture says, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he becomes a what? A new creature. When God works, when he purges you of all of your sin, and then puts his what? Life in you. Glory, glory, glory. What happens? The power of sin over your life is what? Broken. Right? And all of those sins which you have ever committed, all of them are what? Are remitted and washed away. And what? God has no, as far as the east is from the west, God removes those sins from you. Amen. The power of the blood. He was saying about the power of the blood of Jesus. Oh, that power is stronger than the blood. What can wash away your sins?
Yeah.
Hey, what can make me what? Whole again. Nothing but what? The blood of Jesus. Nothing but the what? Blood of Jesus. He took the blood of Jesus. Yes, how many can thank God for the blood today? And that's the thing that happens when you are saved and when you receive the life of God. The power of spiritual death over your life is completely what? Broken. Amen. Whether you believe it is, whether you understand it, I know many times people don't understand what happens when they get saved. They don't understand, amen, how their standing changes from what? Being not in right standing with God and bad standing with God. You know, Bible says that we were alienated and enemies in our minds by what? Wicked works. That's what Sister Hill just read. That doesn't sound like me. To me, you were in right standing with God. So like to me, you were in what? Bad standing.
Yes.
How many ever been in bad standing with somebody?
Yes.
How many of you are in bad standing with somebody? You know, sometimes when you do certain stuff, you just lose standing with folks. They don't want to have no more than what? Do it. Cancel you or just write you off that list when you're in bad standing.
That's right.
Amen. So we were in bad standing with God because of what? Sin. And all of it came through Adam because all of us had the propensity to sin. We just kept on sinning after what Adam did because we couldn't have it. Right? Everybody had it, but couldn't have it. Some people still got the can't help us. They don't see how, I mean, we teach all this about who we are in Christ, but that don't register with most people. People still feel like what? They still what? Can't help from what? Doing wrong. Amen. So scripture says what the law couldn't do, it was weak through the flesh. God sent in his only son in the likeness of sinful flesh and condemned sin in the flesh. Amen. That was through his death. He condemned it. In other words, he what? He struck a death blow to sin. In other words, amen, praise God, he actually destroyed the power of sin to hold you in bondage. So the life of God is very powerful. The grace of God goes very deep. It goes so deep, scripture says, it will even purge you
from dead works. I mean, it will purge your conscience. And, you know, if you can get on a sin conscience, you'll be a master. You'll be master over the devil. If you can get over what? Sin consciousness. You know, the devil did a real job on humanity, because many times people can get free from sin. They can get what? Saved and filled with the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues and all of that. But they still have a consciousness of what? A lot of the wrong doings and things that what transpired in their life in years past. They still, that goes real deep. Amen. And nothing can remove the stain of sin and all of the what? The effects that sin wrought in us. Can nothing remove that but what? The blood of Jesus. When I say the blood of Jesus, I don't mean that, amen, just the literal blood, you know what I'm saying, that it's that. You gotta have what faith that Jesus had to what paid the price with his blood and all of those provisions that he what? He paid for through his blood. You gotta what? You gotta what? Begin to what? Amen. You gotta begin to what? Stand on them. You gotta begin to acknowledge them. Hallelujah. And when you begin to, you know, everything in this life, you overcome by words. That's the reason, that's the way God gave Adam to rule the universe. Through what? Words. That's how God rules the universe. The Bible says he upholds all things by the what? Word of his power. And that's the way Jesus dominated the universe. Through what? The words that came out of his mouth. But the first time, what? He missed it. Just like a whole lot of us are missing it.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. But let me tell you, the second Adam got it right.
Amen.
Praise God. And the Bible says, amen. The Bible says God predetermined years ago that we would be conformed to the image of his what?
Yes.
Son. In other words, everything Jesus can do, did. Everything Jesus did, whatever way he operated, whatever example he what gave us, that's the example we are to what follow. We are just what little Jesus. The Bible says we were made slightly lower. Hallelujah. How many can say amen?
Amen.
But Jesus had all authority in heaven and earth.
Hallelujah.
I give it to you.
Hey.
You ain't been shortchanged. Everything that Adam lost out on, it has been regained, recaptured, recovered. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory, glory.
Amen.
So God has made us, amen, praise God, in his image, in the image of his son. So, amen. How many thank God for making us like Jesus? Amen. Hallelujah. Christ in you. Everybody just said Christ in you.
Christ in you.
Say that again. Christ in you.
Christ in you.
Christ in me. Come on, say that. Some people say, well, I'll say it, but Christ in you, but they won't say Christ in me. How many can say Christ in me? The hope of glory. You know why God put the grace in us? Grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. And God, well, you'd be trying to figure it out in a jillion years. The sum total, everybody just said the sum total of everything that God has done for us through Christ. And that's now doing for us through the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
He is still doing for us through the what? Holy Ghost. I like the little illustration, the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. You know, a shepherd is what?
is concerned about every aspect of a person's need. He's concerned about everything that concerns the sheep. And the Holy Ghost is serving the role as what? The shepherd.
Glory to God.
Hey, hey. How many of us believe, thank God for the Holy Ghost being in you? Christ in you. Hey! How many just said Christ in me?
Christ in me.
How many just feel like just double up and shout? Christ in me. The reason why God said great, you know, the Bible says, I mean, brother Al says, but the Lord is a son in you. And he says that in prayer a lot of times. The Lord God is a son in you. He gives grace and glory. Everybody just said, He gives grace and glory. And the Lord, could you put your hands up and say, He gives grace and glory? Kind of wave at it. He gives grace and glory. And you know the reason why God gives grace? Because He wants you to put grace in you so He can get glory out of you. The Bible says He has given us everything. Let's think about what He ain't given you that pertains to life. Tell me, think about what you ain't got.
Come on.
Bible says all things are yours.
Amen.
That means that everything that Adam was beat out of, cheated out of, fooled out of,
come on,
and tricked out of, Bible says, for this reason, Jesus became what? Poor. Amen. He came down and what? Became poor. So that through His poverty, we might be what? Made great. In other words, He wants to what? Turn it back just like it was to start out. And that's the way it is now. A lot of times people don't know it. Because many times we don't even understand that we have a what? A standing with God. I love it. A standing with God. Like the standing Adam had before he ever knew sin. He was the crown of God's creation.
Amen. That's good.
He was the crown. Mm. So that thing has been flipped back. A lot of people don't even know that. Sometimes I'm up. Sometimes I'm down. Sometimes I'm almost. Man is prone to sin as a fox, what? Prone to fly up. Amen. That's ignorance. See, people that experience defeat, people that's not walking in victory, they either don't know that they're saved. In other words, probably they're not hooked up with the power that I'm hooked up with. They either don't know that they're hooked up with Christ, or either they don't know who they are in Christ. They don't understand their standing. The standing. See, righteousness is not holiness, is what you're holding. See, if you don't know who you are in Christ, if you don't know what position and what place you hold in the mind of God, you know, in the Bible, the Bible keeps on talking about who we are in Christ. Over 130 times, it says, in Christ, in Christ, you in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, you in Christ, in Christ. That's a big deal.
Yes, it is.
That's a position. That's a place you occupy in the heart of God.
Glory to God.
You have what? Direct access.
Yes.
Bible says, come boldly.
Glory to God.
Before the throne of God.
Yes.
Amen. To receive what? Grace and mercy to help. And help in the time of need.
Yes, Lord.
And the one that Brother Tipwell jumped on last week, he said that Job 33 just thrills me. I like that again. See, this is your standing. If you understand your standing, then the holiness thing ain't going to be a big deal. Because you know that you have what? Direct access.
Yes, Lord.
You can come into His what? Presence? Through the virtue of the blood that has already been what? Shed.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Yes,
hallelujah.
You
have confidence and access with boldness through the blood.
Yes.
In other words, the work has already been done. Satan has already been dethroned.
Yes.
He's already a defeated. from Adam's what? Transgression.
Amen.
The table has been turned.
Yes,
you're back. You've been called back. Woo! Probably can say, call back. Call back. Woo.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Call back. But now he has what? Reconciled us back. In other words, brought us back. Everything the devil what took away, he's going to what? Give it back to you many, many times. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. To compensate for what the damaged old smoothly did to you.
Amen.
That's the reason why the Bible says when we were dead in trespasses and sin, he has what? He has quickened us together with him, and then he has raised us up. Oh Lord Jesus, raise us up to sit with him. Oh, shout in my heart. Raise us up to what? Sit with him in what? Heavenly places.
Amen.
Don't put y'all way down underneath all that. I mean, the devil, y'all give the devil so much credit. But the Bible says, sing this under your feet. Amen. Whosoever was born of God does not commit sin. Ooh.
Amen.
Ooh.
Amen. Amen.
Ain't nobody excited about that. I don't believe that's in the Bible. Whosoever is born of God does not habitually commit sin, for the seed remains in him, and he can't sin because he's what? Born of God. In other words, you're not walking in the flesh anymore, right? But you're walking what the law couldn't do, what works couldn't do, because even if you're trying to do it in the strength of your own ability, amen, you can't do it. But the Bible says what the law couldn't do, what works couldn't do, God sent his only begotten Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in those who walk not after the what? Flesh, but what? After the Spirit. Your responsibility is that you gotta walk. You gotta walk in the Spirit. You're right. You gotta walk. Amen. You can't continue to walk in the flesh. You shouldn't even want to reap the benefits of the fruit of the flesh. The flesh ain't got nothing. Amen. Praise God that you need, right? I mean, praise God. If you were happy with the flesh, why do you seek Jesus out anyway? Going back to your, you know, what were the songs that tried Jesus? If you don't like him, the devil will take you back. Try Jesus. You don't like him? The devil will be glad to take it back. All right. How many men that you're seated above in heavenly places in Christ Jesus? Amen. Praise God. As he is, so am I.
Yes,
please. Say it again. As he is.
As he is.
Say it again. As he is.
As he is.
So am I. That in the Bible?
Yes.
Yes, in there. As he is, so am I. If he's above, I'm above. If he's more than a conqueror, then I am what? If he's strong, then I'm what? The Bible says, amen, so many forget that. Oh, Lord, so many forget that. Seated with him. Amen. How many glad that you're seated with him? How many glad you're seated with him? Oh, far above. Everybody just said far above. Far above. I mean, you ain't barely making it, you know, barely getting along. Amen. But you're far above all principality and what? Power.
Yes.
And might. And dominion. That means all the devil got going. You're far above.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. You're far above. Everybody just say, I'm far above. Amen. So one thing I wanted to get over, and I have to take time, probably on Wednesday nights, to get all these scriptures over, but all of the scriptures that talk about the access that we have into God's presence. Amen. Just like a child that's in good standing with his parent. You never have to what? Wonder whether he has what he has the approval of the acceptance of his what? Of his father. Amen. And that's what Job 33:26 says, that Let's read that again, Job 33:26. Let's read that again, Job 33:26. Okay.
He shall pray unto God.
Okay.
And he will be favorable unto him.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall see his face with joy.
Okay.
But he will render unto man his righteousness.
Okay, now that is speaking about exactly what I have been describing. The standing has been what? Restored. Whereas in the Old Testament, God didn't mess with the spiritually dead unless he did it through the divine way that he had appointed. The priest or the angel. However, God wanted to speak, but he didn't deal with people on a what? Heart to heart, face to face. Amen. Because he did not live in the what? Heart of man. Because the heart had to be what? Has to have some what? Work done. Because he was destined and wicked, and God couldn't come in and live in nobody's what? Corrupt heart until the blood of Jesus had been what? Shed. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, so let's get out the scripture before we even have to, shout me out. All right, 2 Corinthians 5:21, let's just say that again. 2 Corinthians 5:21. This shows about your standing. And right now, I just want you to understand that you have access into this presence. God sees you, sees your face with joy. Amen. He welcomes you. You're accepted in his beloved. He loves you just as much as he loves Jesus. God loves you. That's in the Bible. I mean, someone else would be scared to say, God loves me as much as he loves you. But that's what the Bible says here. St. John 17:23. You can write it down and read it yourself later on. So that means what? I'm in good standing, right? He's eager to see me. He's eager to show. Amen. He's eager for me to what? Show up. He's a come bold that was on the throne of grace. He said, I've got the living to make intercession for you. The ever living. That's what he lives for. Just to what? Make intercession. Just make it. Woo, glory. Yeah. Oh, baby, that shit kill up. You know, these little scriptures and things, but if you grab hold to them and really begin to what, use them in your quiet time and prayer time and speak these things back to God, it will make you a what? A conqueror, more than a conqueror. I mean, it will build you up. Amen. Praise God. It will really give you a real grip or revelation of your place and your standing in the sight of God. Okay. 2 Corinthians 5:21. I have to read that's from scripture. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Say that again. Read it again, please.
For he hath made him to be sin for us,
mm-hmm.
who knew no sin,
mm-hmm.
that we might be made the righteousness of God in him.
Okay, so we're the righteousness of God. Okay, 1 Corinthians 1:30. We're going to have to shut out, shut down. But these scriptures shows us that we have freedom into God's presence, which is something altogether different than the way it was under the old covenant. It started out in this form, but Adam blew it. He lost the privilege of what? Communicating and responding to God. Remember when after he had sinned in the garden, he had to what? Cover himself with what? Thick leaves and right? And he was scared of God. He was running from God when God was calling out for him. Adam, where art thou? Amen. He was what? He was running, full of fear, because he had lost his standing with God. But now, through the second Adam, that standing has been what? Restored. And we have free access, means, boy, that means that what? Anything you ask in his name, according to his will, God, what? He gives you. How many know the power of prayer? The ability to decree things and the things that you decree will be established.
Yeah.
How many know the benefit of having that free access before the throne? Anything comes up, anytime you feel down and discouraged or distress, you got a telephone in your bosom. You can bring them up from your heart. And he ain't trying to hide from you. He ain't trying to what, duck you. He ain't trying to what, cheat you out of nothing. If he wanted to cheat you out of it, he didn't want you to have it, all he would have had to done is what? Not send Jesus. If he had withheld Jesus, he would have got nothing no way.
Bible says, who shall lay anything to God? Amen. Who is he that condemneth? God ain't trying to cheat you out of nothing.
Amen.
He didn't come that you might not have life.
Yes.
He came that you might have life.
Yes.
And to have it what?
More
abundant. Amen. Just touch somebody close to you and say, God is for you.
God is for you.
I wish you understood it. God is for you.
Yes, he is.
If he didn't spare his only son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him
freely?
I can just shout.
Teaching us that we can live what? We
should live what? Righteousness. See, the grace of God is the thing that God gives us to give to makes us what? Overcome us in the area of our sanctification. We don't have to give in to Satan's temptations, right? Amen. The grace of God. Turn somebody and say, the grace of God teaches you something, babe. See, Christ has become your what? The source of your sanctification. It's through His grace. How many can say amen? And the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that we can deny, we can. See, it's a whole lot in knowing. Oh, how many people is a whole lot in knowing? It's a whole lot in knowing who you are in Christ. Knowing your position. So that means you have not only access to the throne whenever you want it. Secondly, you have what? Power and authority over all power. You have what? Rulership. You are absolutely in control. The Bible says through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign. How many know that? That includes sin, sickness, disease, poverty, whatever it is. That's not of God. Lift your hand and say, I reign. How many believe it? I reign. Can you say it again? I reign. I'm the ruler.
Get all these little things that God has made you
and began to what? Speak them out boldly before the Lord. Boy, you will become a powerful man.
Yes, hallelujah.
You become a, you know, somebody, the giant told a midget, what's the secret of you getting so big? The giant asked the midget, well, just tell me, Mr. Giant, how do you get so big? 8 or 9 feet tall? The giant say, if you want to grow big like me, you gotta learn the giant talk. What language you gotta learn? Spanish, German? No, he said you gotta learn the giant language. The giant talk. And that's what all of us need to learn. Rather than letting Satan beat you up on every side, you need to open your mouth and exert your rulership with your authority. Because you got power and authority to put everything that's coming after you back in its place.
Amen.
Because you're what? You're exalted now.
Yes. Amen.
You're exalted now. Amen. I'm done. Let's all stand.
Amen.